Welcome to 6 months Later, the podcast 180 days in the making, where we talk to interesting people about their lives and hopes for the future. And then we talk to them again in 6 months to sort of check in on things. I'm here. My name is Tara Newton Wordsworth, and I'm here with my co-host, Matthew Shadon. What a legend.
Tara Newton Wordsworth.
That's us. What a lovely thing. Quite a pair to
How are you doing today, Tara?
Yeah, I'm doing okay. I mean, I've had one of those days, you know, one of those days where you're living life on the edge and you're thinking, I don't know, should I be here? Should I be in Spain? I ended up going for a walk by myself and I just thought, you know what I need? Like, I need a break. I need to be alone for 2 weeks. That's what I need. And then I would be fine. But I have two children and a husband. So, you know, That's not going to happen. But it's more that the thought of it in itself was relaxing enough to make me feel slightly better. And then trapped. Really? How are you?
I'm all right. I love how you said you were living life on the edge and you're like, I went for a walk today. I'm all right. I am actually on vacation, not for 2 weeks, but for a long weekend. I'm down in Cornwall, swimming, and actually I've been working from home from Cornwall for 3 days, but now I'm actually on vacation. Yeah, I'm all right. Things are going all right. You had exciting news. You told me that you have a show tomorrow.
Oh, yeah. I have my first stand-up gig in, I guess, I don't know how long it's been since we've been living like this, but I guess like 4.5, 5 months or something. And it's really exciting because, you know, I'm excited to do it. Stuart Goldsmith is headlining, and I love the Comedian's Comedian podcast, so I'm so stoked to be opening that gig and obviously hopefully meeting him, but keeping at a social distance. I've received a very strict email about safety measures, so we all have to stay 2 meters apart. I feel very excited, but at the same time that sort of mild anxiety about like just having not done it in such a long time. But but you know, it's nice. It's a nice feeling that things are kind of starting back up again, but it also still feels quite strange. Like it almost feels like we're still not quite, well, we're not back to normality yet, are we?
No. Well, what's the deal with the microphone? Are they just going to wipe it down between every act, or
you they've actually got three different mics, and no one's allowed to shake. You're not allowed to shake the MC's hand or anything. The MC will have their mic, and then they will pass you a mic as you come onto the stage. And then after your act, that mic will be wiped down. The next person will have a separate mic, and yeah, so it's everything's. You won't be handling the same mic as anybody. And
yeah, that sounds exciting. It's you have worked on your set, I'm sure. Do you have any new stuff, or are you just kind of like going back to the old stuff rather than risk?
I'm going to do a lot of the old stuff, but I have incorporated sort of lockdown-y references to kind of modernize it. Like when I reference other gigs, it's a Zoom gig that I'm referencing, or, you know, just little things about sort of, I don't know, living my normal complaints about toddlers, but with lockdown incorporated and that kind of stuff. So, you know, so it feels like more modern. But I think especially when you're opening, you have that kind of pressure of you need to, you know, have goodish stuff. So you can't just go up there and do like new material that no one's seen for 5 months and living in your fantasy world. You're like, oh, this is really good stuff, man. And you get up there and everyone's like, why are you opening this gig?
Like, I have 10 minutes on pajamas that I think is going to really kill. You're going to be like, hey guys, what's the deal with airline food? Like, seriously, do you think it still exists anymore?
Yeah.
I haven't been out of my house in 6 months.
Oh God. So what about you? Obviously your baby news is still really exciting. I'm still really excited about
that. For you, it's just dread for me.
Are you dreading it? How are you feeling?
No, I'm good. I vacillate on it. Like today to my wife, I was like, did we make a mistake? And she was like, I don't know, probably.
Oh my God, that's awesome.
But yeah, it's good. We took the train down here to Cornwall, and we booked first class. Pro tip. It was really good because it was very sparsely populated cabin, first class. It was the first train I'd been on in like 6 months, which was ridiculous. It was a small pleasure I thought I'd never experience again. But we were looking at strollers and things, and man, that's a scam, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, look, I'll be honest with you. We got ours secondhand because if you buy, especially the posh ones, like new, you're looking at least a grand, like at least.
That's what Alice has been on like Facebook Marketplace looking for. We're trying to get the hand-me-downs of Oxford, which is generally pretty posh stuff.
Yeah, it's fantastic when you live in a fairly posh area because you can just get like really nice stuff. Yeah. Like no, they're normally like, oh, I'd give it to you, but you know, is £10 okay? And you're like, yes, thank you. That would be money means nothing to them. So they're just like, oh, okay.
I had friends who like were fairly poor on what was otherwise a very affluent island in Puget Sound near Seattle. And they were like, yeah, there's this thing called FreeCycle. She was like obsessed with FreeCycle because she had three kids. She had triplets actually. And then she was just like, and they just, you just go there and they're just like, here's a bunch of toys. Or like, she got a little too crazy because the last time I visited them, they was like an easy chair that she'd gotten that had some very suspect stains on it. And like, no, this is fine. It's fine. And her husband was like, this is not fine. This is not good. Like, there's too many, like there's a weird stain where the head goes. It's like, it really.
Oh gosh.
Yeah. So we're trying to, you actually gave me the best piece of advice I think that anybody's given me, which is that you can just buy big lots of baby clothes on eBay. Mm-hmm. And we were looking at that a bunch on the train and just like, you know, here's 20 outfits for a 6 month old. And it's like £5. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah. They were amazing. Definitely go for the bundles, especially because a lot of the time you do get really nice quality stuff in there where it would normally be like £10 each. I mean, I cannot believe how expensive baby clothes are when they last literally like 3 months. That is a pro tip for any baby shoppers out there. Yeah. Anything else exciting happening this week in the world for you, Matt?
No. Oh, I did watch that puzzle movie. Yeah, it's pretty good. I cannot wait to talk to Esther about it in 6 months.
Oh my gosh. What is it actually about? Like, does it actually have a plot, you know?
Yeah, no, it's about a lady who is like a put upon housewife and she realizes that she's wasted her life through the medium of puzzles and she like reinvents herself, you know? It's great. Actually, you know what I found out? This was the most fascinating thing is I looked it up on IMDb and I found out it is actually a remake of a Spanish film. And now my goal is to find the original Spanish film and see it.
And you're going
to
be like realizing in 6 months time that you've wasted your life like watching puzzle movies.
No, that's never been a waste. That would never be a waste.
Okay, cool. Well, let me know how that goes. And how about 6 months time? Like what are you thinking will be happening in 6 months?
Early February, Groundhog's Day. I think we'll have the groundhog will probably see his shadow and we'll have 6 more weeks of quarantine. What about you, Tara?
Okay, so 6 months time for me, I don't know, February. I hate February in England. No offense, you know, UK people, but I just think it is horrific. And it's just that feeling of like, it just grinds on and you're just like, oh, when is there going to be the faintest hint of warmth in my life again? Yeah.
And then your husband's like, I'm in the room.
Actually, have you noticed everyone's having lockdown babies? I mean, you're one of these people.
Nobody I know has having a lockdown baby, but maybe you're in a different group, friend circle than I do.
I keep bumping into friends and I'm like, oh my God, you're pregnant. And they're like, yeah. And it's like, well, what else are you going to do when you're trapped with your partner for 5 months? So yeah. But anyway, so I think that'll be the time that there will be a lot of lockdown babies being born. And that'll be great for me because I get to enjoy lots of tiny babies and I love babies, but don't need any more for myself right now. And that's it on my predictions. Lots of lockdown babies being born and just middle of deep, cold, dark winter still. But I'm excited for this week's guest. Do you want to talk about this week's guest?
Yeah, we have an amazing New York-based comedian and sex worker advocate, Kaytlyn Bailey. So with no further ado, we should go and talk to Kaytlyn.
Thank you.
Hello and welcome, comedian, sex worker rights advocate, and host of the Oldest Profession podcast, Kaytlyn Bailey. Welcome, Kaytlyn. Thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you so much for having me. It is thrilling to be here. What is this called again?
6 months later.
6 months later. All right. Sweet.
You're a huge fan
of the show. I've been assured that this won't be released for at least six months.
So I just wanted to. Great. Okay. Yeah. So we're going to do the other half of this interview in 6 months' time, which is pretty exciting.
Early February. Yeah.
Oh, cool. That'll be... So the date is July 30th. Today is... So we're in the middle of summer. You guys can also provide the context. Like, there's a global pandemic. There's an election that nobody has any faith in coming up. Like, there's a lot of shit going down.
We could timestamp. Herman Cain died today.
Yeah.
Wow.
Like, who even remembered that guy? And then 6 months later, people would be like, oh, yeah, the 999 guy?
Of COVID. Whoa. He died of COVID. Very important.
She's so topical. Today,
Donald Trump announced that he might delay the election, which is like...
I guess that was bigger news. So
I think it just speaks to the time. You know, and my whole Twitter feed is like, he can't do that. And I'm like, well, he can't invade cities with ICE agents either. But here we are. So, you know,
we thought it couldn't start concentration camps, but
and here we've been for way longer than anyone's comfortable talking about. So, like, yeah, it's a lot.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. How are you finding it living in America during this time?
Oh, it is. Well, it's very weird. I actually just wrote an essay about that. Sorry, that's my colleague calling, and my very helpful tech husband has set up such a thing where now my phone calls and text messages also appear on my computer. So it's actually impossible for me to write. I can't put my things away. And so I used to be able to just hang up on people quietly and without acknowledging it, but now it goes straight into my computer. I got married in October, so we're still figuring that out. So it's been a fun... Well, I got married during a time when people could leave their house. And so I married a busy person. And now, you know, we're just in retirement way too early, and we're not okay with that. But
hey, congratulations.
Thank you.
In that sentence. Congratulations.
Huge accomplishment.
I forget where we started with that. Yeah, but good.
I won. So I don't
you won. No.
I don't know. It wasn't really a competition. It wasn't like that. You know, we had a healthy relationship, but it was consensual.
That's a relief.
Wow. Okay.
My husband and I, we had just bought an apartment in Chelsea in Manhattan, and we're starting a renovation. Thank you. but this is just going to be 10 minutes of white people problems. That's all. So we bought an apartment in Chelsea, and we were scheduled to start a renovation in March. So we totally stripped it, right? Like we'd packed everything up. There wasn't a spoon in the apartment because we were supposed to start construction, but that's when the city shut down. And so we'd moved at that point into my West Village apartment, which I had as a comedian, right? And so it was this like little 350 square foot, the toilet is like in the hall. My shower was in the kitchen. I regularly just this tiny little place that we've been living in, which would have been fine if Trey was going to work every day and I was going to shows every night. But once lockdown happened, it only took us like 3 weeks to be like, well, if we want to stay married, we have to leave. So we came down to my parents' lake house. We're both from Raleigh, North Carolina, and we quarantined here with our next door neighbor and also like an old friend from high school, Ed, who's like a delight and a genius, but like can't take care of himself. He was like, I'll just get enough Cliff Bars to ride this out. We were like, come with us. We're taking you home to your mother. And we did that, but we quarantined here because we didn't want to get anyone sick. And like, you know, everyone was really scared and we didn't know anything. And so we went to Raleigh and we'd been there since April, staying with my best friend and her husband. And we are best friends with like no boundaries, but everyone has their limit. And so we had to leave they got a cat. We're both very allergic. Very clear signals. Yeah, but like,
wait, did they get a cat to like
I think so. Time. We needed to leave. Like it was, we were too comfortable. And so now we are back at my parents' lake house and we've been here for about a week. And there are worst, I mean, like we have a amazing situation, right? Like it's, we feel very, very lucky. And also it's been really disruptive. Like no one knows the future. It's hard to plan for anything. And we just keep uprooting ourselves into like one temporary situation after another. Like there's no office, right? There's nowhere to like set up really.
Right. That's very stressful.
Yeah.
Did you get out of New York while it was kind of really getting bad, or did you get out before?
I mean, we got out as it was getting really bad. You know, like Cuomo was doing his daily press conferences. It was like, you know, the front page of the news. It was before the restaurants had all shut down.
Oh, okay.
Did you feel scared at all?
Yes, but not of getting sick. I felt scared for the disruption and the lack of infrastructure and the lack of support, because I do, you know, as a sex worker rights advocate, I spend a lot of time with, you know, with community organizers and people that are really vulnerable, you know, and these kinds of disruptions, I feel like I understood what the fallout was going to be of, like, you know, school shutting down and restaurants and like all of these people that are out of work. And like, we just don't have a good social safety net in this country for so many people, like generally speaking, but, you know, for undocumented immigrants, for sex workers, for, you know, for incarcerated folks. Like I was working with a lot of the shutdown Rikers folks. And so it's the human casualties were immediate and urgent. You know, it's like these big system shifts. My husband and I are privileged enough to sort of like ride what comes, you know, both like able-bodied. Both of us have continued to be paid during this period. Like both of us have health insurance. We have our social support network is full of people with extra resources, you know, like this is not the only vacation home that we have like social access to, but like it's so dumb, right? But like there are so many people that don't have a primary residence. So like I have a bunch of friends that were on tour, you know, that had like leased out or subletted their apartment and were supposed to be on tour right now. And like where, you know, people who have been on people's couches, like not even in their lush spare bedroom, but like in people's space since March, that have no income. Right. That like, and you know, how do you get an apartment in that situation? How do you move in that situation? How, you know, people are trapped. We wanted to get out of the city to reduce density. It felt like the socially appropriate thing to do. Right. Like those that can leave should. And also it's a selfish decision. And like, we would rather be trapped at a lake house than in a 350 square foot apartment. And desperate people do desperate things. And so like the streets of the city, that you, even in March, you could feel the tension of like, no one knows what's coming, but we all know that it's going to be really bad.
Yeah. Well, it even felt like this in like a really lovely market town in like Britain, in like in Berkshire, which is like super like
Berkshire. That's like, right. It feels like a made up idyllic land.
It is. It's literally like Enid Blyton. Like it's so lovely in this kind of area. And even here, you know, you're going to the supermarkets and everything was bare, and there was just this feeling of like everyone for themselves. And it just, I mean, I just can't imagine what it was like in the cities.
Yeah. I mean, like whole economies are decimated, right? Like as a comic, almost everyone that I knew in the arts world lost their day gig and their night gig at the same time, right? Mm. Restaurants shut down and theaters closed. That's a double whammy, you know? And that's part of the gig economy that is legal, right? To say nothing of like the side hustles and the off the books work that like make the whole city function, right? I think sex work is like a classic example of that, but like the informal economies are decimated, you know, and there's no protection there. I mean, not that there's much protection for like, you know, tax paying legal workers. They're not getting a huge bailout, but there's something, you know? And so, and selfishly, like from an artist perspective and not from a venue owner's perspective, like, you know, those spaces exist and the skill set to create and run those spaces exist, right? So we get, you know, ownership may change, the scene may change, there might be, but like live theater, I think, is going to come back, but we're going to lose a lot of great people during this period. It's going to be like a war, you know, like we're going to lose a generation of art. We're going to lose a generation of people that may have had the economic flexibility or the sense of security to try this that never will, right? Yeah. You know, from that level to people that, you know, have to throw in the towel to venues that shut down and never reopen. Like,
mm-hmm. So this kind of leads on quite nicely to your role, obviously, as a sex worker rights advocate. Sure. Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I have a very fancy job. it's very nice. I am the director of communications for Decriminalized Sex Work, which is a national advocacy organization here in the U.S. fighting for sex worker rights. We are we're pursuing a state-by-state strategy trying to change laws that arrest consensual adult sex workers or their clients. And so we have active campaigns now in 5 states that we can talk about. And we're pursuing a national agenda. You know, we want to decriminalize that, you know?
Amazing.
Two consensual adults engaging in sexual activity with each other isn't a crime, whether money is exchanged or not. And I think that this sort of comes back to like listening. I hate to feel like listen to women because it's like too heteronormative, but like listening and centering people's own experience rather than imposing notions on others, right? Because like the core of criminalizing prostitution is this conflation of prostitution with the horrible crime of human trafficking, right? Of this idea that like people are forced into this work rather than recognizing that sex work is like any other form of labor, people's involvement, and it exists on a spectrum of choice, circumstance, and coercion. Like we don't talk about people being forced to work in slaughterhouses or being forced to work on farms or being forced as domestic laborers, even though those are the areas where the most human trafficking occurs. Instead, we have this sort of caricatured idea that comes from the 19th century, very racist conception of a white slave as justification for cracking down. You know, I feel like I'm going off the rails a little bit here, but like, it's the conflation of human trafficking with sex work comes from a very deep idea that women are not the authors of our own experience and that like sex is done to us and that we are not active agents. And the recognition or the existence of adult consensual sex work, I think, betrays that lie. And so, yeah, that's one of the fights that I'm fighting. And it has everything to do with my conception of myself as like an active agent in my own life. And my feminism is very tied up in that.
Oh, amazing. So would you say, based on your experience of meeting sex workers and sort of talking to them, like, would you say that generally it's something they feel that they want to do and they enjoy doing?
I think that sex work is, you know, it's more like being a waitress than being a Marine, right? It's a form of labor, right? And like, you know, I've worked in a lot of restaurants. Like sometimes I have loved my job. Sometimes I have hated my job and had everything to do with like who my manager and who my customers were. Sex work has always been and will always be all kinds of different things to all kinds of different people. There's no typical sex worker, just like there's no typical food and bev worker. But I would say that the overwhelming majority of people in the sex trade are choosing to do that work either because of economic circumstance or because it's the best of the available options.
And I imagine that decriminalizing it would also create a much bigger support network and safety network as well, and probably massively improve the safety of doing it. I imagine
all of the evidence suggests that that's true, right? Like New Zealand decriminalized prostitution in 2003 with the Prostitution Reform Act and has been one of the only countries in the world to almost eliminate trafficking within the sex trade. And all of that has everything to do with taking it out of the black market. When you are a member of a criminalized class, you can't report crimes committed against you, right? So you can't report rape, you can't report domestic violence, you can't report abusive managers, clients, boyfriend, anything. And so when you decriminalize adult consensual prostitution, you empower sex workers to report the crimes that are committed against them. If they are hit, if they are raped, if they are robbed, suddenly they have access to the formal criminal justice system, where it is in a criminalized environment. They can't, because the distinction between themselves and a malicious criminal actor is erased, right? They're both criminals in this situation.
Right. Wow. That makes so much sense. I really, I love that. I love New Zealand. I feel like they're doing so many great things over there.
Right. Yeah. Just look at how they whooped the coronavirus's butt. I'm telling you, female leadership and common sense laws around sex are like the answer.
Yeah. She's amazing. Their prime minister. I really, I think she's fantastic.
So what form does your kind of advocacy take? Are you guys lobbying, or are you just trying to get out there and educate people?
So we're, you know, in the before times, Most of my job was going to conferences, right? We went to all kinds of conferences, right? We went to the National Coalition of Criminal Defense Lawyers. We went to the adult, same hotel, actually. The conference was in the same hotel like 2 weeks apart, and it was hilarious because like the first one was criminal defense lawyers, and then the second one was the porn industry. I'm going to get in so much trouble for forgetting the name of this very famous conference. Doesn't matter.
We went to the AVN Awards?
Yes, the AVN Awards. That's it.
Oh my God.
No, really. It's fine. I called. It doesn't matter. Sometimes you forget things. We went to the National Coalition of State Legislatures. We went to ALEC. We go to conferences. We set up a booth, right? We have literature that we hand out, but we're trying to impact decision makers, right? We're trying to get our narrative into the public sphere. We went to the, the largest like public health conference. And we're just trying to like announce our presence, right? Because like Amnesty International, the World Health Organization, the ACLU, like Planned Parenthood, everybody, there really is consensus around like the best way to police prostitution is to not, right? That decriminalizing sex work is what human rights advocates all over the world, and it's certainly what sex workers have been advocating for generations. And so we are announcing ourselves in those bigger circles. We have paid lobbyists in the five states that we're working in. We are building relationships with grassroots organizations, and I send out press releases and I give quotes and I make noise and I try to build relationships with journalists to change the story that we're telling about sex workers, right? So is an example of like what my job is. Do you guys remember the Robert Kraft sting that I'm not sure if that made it across the pond? He owns the Patriots, which is a football team.
Oh, right. He was getting a massage.
Right. Yeah. How did you get that story? What was your perception of like how that story happened?
He had been busted at a massage parlor or something like that. Or was it because then that lady ended up like the lady who was running the massage parlor? She ended up at Mar-a-Lago. There was like a whole thing.
Yeah, it was a whole like political drama. So what happened initially was five different law enforcement agencies, including the Department of Homeland Security, using federal money that was earmarked for anti-trafficking operations. They used some like Homeland Security, like the Patriot Act, to fake a bomb scare and install hidden cameras in these Asian massage parlors because they suspected that human trafficking was happening. And so they spent 6 months recording like what sounds like the world's most boring porn. And what they discovered is that legally licensed masseurs, in addition to the massages that were being offered, would on occasion also offer manual and oral stimulation, right? This is a happy ending. So they sent in a coordinated SWAT team and they shut down and they arrested 19 women. They deported one of them. They threatened the remaining 18 with federal charges ranging from trafficking to money laundering to extortion to all kinds of other things. And they publicly humiliated some 200 men who had been caught coming in and out of this place. And one of them was Robert Kraft. So that massage parlor sting is how anti-trafficking raids look all over the country. That's what they look like, right? They're federal agents storming into immigrant-owned businesses, arresting people that they are then turning around and showing the press of like, we've rescued these victims. Really? Because you put them in handcuffs and confiscated their money and threatened them with imprisonment, which like doesn't sound like a rescue to me, but like, what the fuck do I know? So we worked with local sex worker rights advocate and we got all of these women's names and their charges and their attorneys. And we put together a fact sheet and we started sending it around to multiple reporters. And we got one who actually wrote this really fantastic Vanity Fair piece about what this raid is and how it sort of fits within like the difference between what the police say they are doing and what they are actually doing. And so the prosecution had to admit in open court that there was no evidence of trafficking. And Robert Kraft is now fighting Florida on their blatantly unconstitutional use of hidden cameras to arrest consensual adults. Robert Kraft is a 72-year-old widower who paid a 45-year-old woman to massage a different part of his body. Right? To call that human trafficking, right? It's just, you're just wrong. You're wrong about how things work, right? And to conflate what Robert Kraft did with what Jeffrey Epstein did, right?
Oh, God, that's awful.
And rape children. Like, these are different. Asian women are not children. That's not, you know, like, that's, you can't, fuck you. Right? And that, you know, yeah. so we really aggressively tried to shape that story, and we got a couple of news cycles out that at least put on the record, right, the challenging the police's narrative of what happened, which is that they came in as heroes, right? Like right. cavalry, rescuing sex slaves from traffickers like Robert Kraft, who was a Republican and presumably an asshole, but like not a monster.
Right. Do you think that like these days with all the talk of like police reform, that kind of dovetails with what yeah, you're absolutely. Kind of talking think, about?
Yeah, it makes the decriminalization of sex work like suddenly the least radical position in the room. Right?
Oh, okay.
Defund the police. It's like, well, what if we just stopped arresting consensual adults for doing grown-up stuff with each other? What if we just did that? Right? Like, right. You know, we don't have to, you can defund whatever you want, but like, it is, I think, ridiculous and ludicrous to think through how much money is being spent on spying, surveilling, arresting, and prosecuting people that are guilty of getting together.
Right.
Mm. It's weird, isn't it? Obviously, there are lots of ways that you could compare it to sort of normal people being with someone for money. You know, I see like as in someone closer, being...
Right. Like, I just got married in October, and I tell my husband straight up. Well, it's safe. Yeah. Nailed it.
We're all married here, okay?
You're having a baby, right? You're getting, like, grown-up bingo over there. So.
I know, yeah. Well, yeah. It took me long enough. I don't think it counts as grown-up anymore.
You're not adulting into your 40s. You're not allowed to call it that anymore.
No, it's just like, you're just a sad old man with the baby now.
Something I tell my husband is like, if I just loved you, I would just love you. But like, in addition to being someone that I want to spend the rest of my life with, this is also a property contract. It's one of the, what I'm trying to say, like, sex work is one of those things where like, closer you look, the more nebulous it becomes of like, what it is or what it isn't, or where every state draws the line, or like, what counts as an exchange, right? What's a transaction and what isn't? And I think that there is something fundamentally sexist that it frames, you know, public woman is so synonymous with sex work, right? Or the public participation of like, this idea that the preciousness, right? This idea that like, when a man and a woman get together, the woman wakes up having lost something, right? And the man wakes up having gained something is so rooted in the way that we think about and we conceive sex work that it obscures what it is, right? We let the story about what it is get in the way of what it is, and it erases this wild tapestry of experience. So I feel like I've spent 40 minutes as the director of communications for decriminalized sex work, you know, like convincing you guys about why it's a good idea, which it definitely is.
Obviously, there are other things you're up to as well. And I did want to talk to you about that. And also because in the future, when we talk to you in 6 months, we want to sort of talk sure. about your predictions for where you think you'll be in 6 months, yep. what you think you'll be up to. And so what's in the pipeline at the moment?
Yeah, well, I just quit my dream job is sort of what just happened. So 2 weeks ago, I put in my notice because I need to do my own thing. I believe that people have mixed motives for everything. You know, there are like lots of reasons to do anything, but I mentally quit my job when my boss spoke to the Washington Post in February when he should not have. And so I am sort of unwilling to be the spokesperson for somebody else's organization, even though I agree with the mission and I believe in the incredible work of my colleague. I am like, no longer willing to represent an organization that is run by someone I would have fired. So yeah.
So are you upset that about what he said, or the fact that he did it when you were the communication?
All of it. Yeah, absolutely. So I'm upset with the broken promise, right? Of like, I'm somebody that believes trying to do everything is just the most exhausting and expensive way to do nothing. And so I believe in, you know, we set our focus really, really narrowly that we wanted to end the prohibition of prostitution in the US. And so I was willing to like, look, if you don't think that you can do good things with bad men's money, then like, are you a sex worker rights advocate? You know, like it's, you know, so I had no problem taking money from libertarians or like people that I disagree with huge chunks of their platform in order to get the funds to get things done, right? Which is to stop the arrests and to elevate the voices of sex workers in politics, right? Like get meetings with senators. Like you have to pay lobbyists in C4 money. That's what you have to do. And so this guy comes from the marijuana legalization world and is tied into, you know, a lot of sources of funding in like the tech world. And he started a marijuana legalization company in the 1990s and has some chauvinistic beliefs about women and like is not good at talking about this subject. But he's also connected to deep pockets and had a political action and strategy that I felt like I could get on board with the understanding that as the communications director, I'm the only person that talks to the press. He can't talk good on this subject. And I didn't want this to be campaign to decriminalize sex work, right? I wanted this to be the campaign to decriminalize sex work. We're getting funding from this source. We're investing in these strategies. This is a coalition of many, many different voices that are coming together, all asking for the same thing, which is stop the arrest. But when he talks, it's like impossible not to quote him because he's just like the dumbest. Like you can go back through and like read the newspaper articles. He's like physically incapable of like not sticking his foot in his mouth. Like just can't do it. And so I was like, look, when we initially started, he talked to the press and like had a conversation with a journalist. I was brand new at my job. I didn't know better. He gave a couple of bad quotes. And I was like, that's it. Like, if I'm going to continue to work here, you cannot talk to the press. And so, we started a campaign in DC. The local advocates were very anxious about working with us. They didn't want to be associated with this guy, which like, I totally get. And, they were like, we don't want to work with this guy. And the Washington Post called and said like, can I talk to him? And I was like, nope, I'm the communications director. This is what's happening in DC. I'll be in DC. We'll have representatives in DC. But the big thing that we're sending to DC is money. We want to put the campaign to decriminalize sex work on a ballot initiative. And the reason that we want to do that in 2020 is that we're polling at 55%. It's a presidential election. We're not going to have this opportunity for another 4 years. And we think we can win. And we would like to work with you, right? And they were like, well, we don't want to work with you. And we were like, okay, well, the thing about having money is that we can do this anyway. And at polling at 55%, it sort of doesn't matter if you're with us on these issues. We think we can win without you. And then talked to the press and gave just a horrific quote where I was just like, I don't want to have anything to do with this. So we pulled out of DC. And that's when I decided that I can't work for other people, that I need to start my own thing. And so I am still committed to changing the stories about sex workers. I think that legislation is going to flow downstream of culture here. I feel like over and over and over again, sitting in legislators' offices, like I said before, the story of what prostitution is kept getting in the way of like the way that this legislation like actually is enacted on the ground. And so I started a production company. I secured a couple of donors and a grant, and I started Old Pro Productions. So we are launching in September with season 3 of the Oldest Profession podcast. But I've hired a producer and a historian and a PR team. And I am working with local sex worker advocates all over the country in a way that I couldn't attach to this organization that was attached to this baggage and this bad decision maker who was ultimately the leader. He had hiring and firing power, and like it would just be disingenuous for me to pretend that DSW was the movement when I knew that it was like this guy's org. But the movement is big, the movement is national, the movement is right, and my contribution to that can be as a storyteller. And so that's what Old Pro Productions is going to be all about, is elevating sex worker stories.
And in addition to your own podcast, are you going to be doing other podcasts from sex workers or for other people?
That is TBD, right? So we're really putting all of our eggs in the Oldest Profession podcast basket. I also have a one-woman show, Whore's Eye View, that was ready for readings in the before times, but with national live theater shut down for the foreseeable future, we're put that on ice for a while.
I was going to ask you about that. What can you talk about that a little bit?
Whore's Eye View. It's my second one-woman show, and it is 10,000 years of history from a sex worker's perspective, specifically my perspective as a sex worker. And so it's, I would say, like part stand-up, part history lecture, part one woman show storytelling, right? So it's me sort of personalizing this history. And I talk about the history of sex work, the history of criminalizing sex work, and the history of using whorephobia as a sort of an entry point of misogyny, and the way that laws and prejudices and ideas about sex workers limit the freedom of movement and freedom of expression of all women.
Amazing. Well, I just feel, yeah, I feel really excited for you that you've started this company, because this guy, I know nothing about this guy that you're saying is kind of the guy in charge, but
he's a very effective fundraiser, which like matters and is rare. If there was somebody else who was bringing more than $1 million to the table, I'd work with them too. That's what makes me a good whore, right? Like I have no problem, right? Like making those kinds of calculations, but I became unwilling to deal with the rest. Like ultimately the calculation became, I think that I can do better without him, right? That's ultimately, this dude's baggage is getting in the way of my goal, right? Which is still the goal of the organization, to end the prohibition of prostitution in the US, right?
Yeah. But, and also it feels like you have a lot to say about your genuine experience of having been a former sex worker. It just makes so much more sense to have someone who's a former sex worker doing the quotes, you know?
And I'm a calculating cunt, you know what I mean? So I like I'm mentally disconnected, right? Valentine's weekend, the Washington Post article came out and I was like, that's it, I'm leaving. But like any abuse survivor, the decision to leave and actually leaving are different steps. So I started conceiving, right, of like, what do I want to do, right? Like, what do I actually want to do? And at that point, Whore's Eye View was mostly written and was looking really promising. And I just connected with a director that I really wanted to work with. And so we were talking more seriously about that. And I like secured this reading series. And then, you know, I was wiggling around the idea in my head of restarting the Oldest Profession podcast and understanding like the power of historical figures that really lived, and rewriting ourselves into sort of the national narrative and the history of various like cities and states and the country, and also like globally, because the Oldest Profession, like, we've been around for a while and like we've done shit. It's very cool. So those ideas were like really front of mind. And then, you know, I started, you know, doing some media projects within DSW, like making little short films and little explainer videos. And I just, you know, wanted to do it my way. Like that, you know, like that was sort of it. Like, I'm here out of stubbornness and spite. Like, I'd rather start my own thing than work with other people. So, you know, I convinced, you get it, Matthew. Right? And I'm a comic at heart. And so just a pill of a person. And so I talked to some folks, a huge fan of the show, a huge fan of the Oldest Profession podcast, just so happened to email me with like, hey, it's been a year since you've released anything. Like, are you doing more of this? And if not, can I make you do that? And I was like, well, we would need real money. And he was like, well, that's why I called. And so he was my first grant. And I bullied him. We weren't able to meet in person at all because like COVID happened. So it was really like a phone call and my body of work that was enough for him to trust me with like a very generous starter grant. And from there, I hired a website design person. I hired a producer. I found a fiscal sponsor so that we could accept more C3 money and like built Old Pro Productions, Inc. And got incorporated and got a bank account all during the global pandemic. You know, like, so things that we're just moving from house to house, but I started a company during the pandemic. And so that's what's up. And we are launching our first episode end of August, early September, knock on wood.
Exciting.
I hope. Yeah.
Really exciting.
Yeah.
So cool.
So when we talk to you again, you should be in the middle of season 3.
Yeah, we should be in the middle of season 3. At that point, we should have released like 4 or 5 episodes. And if public life has resumed, which I don't think it will in 6 months, like maybe in 18 months, but not 6. But the next step for us is going to be touring Whore's Eye View, hopefully with the audience that we're able to build from the podcast. So that's our next step. Yeah.
Wow. That is so exciting. Yeah. I'm really looking forward to it. Hopefully you can bring it to the UK and we can see it.
Yes. Yeah, that would be awesome. I would love
Edinburgh ever starts up again.
Do you have any massive swing predictions for what will be happening in 6 months' time? Doesn't have to be realistic. It can be whatever. What a massive prediction can be about yourself or just the world in general.
We're not going to have a peaceful transfer of power. I don't know how exactly the election is going to be fucked up, right? Like, I don't know if it's going to be delayed or if it's going to be massive fraud or if it's going to be like foreign. I don't know how, but like, there's no way I cannot envision. I can't envision a peaceful transfer of power, right? Like, no matter what happens, I feel like whoever wins the election is not going to be seen as legitimate by enough people to create massive instability. I do not think we come out of this pandemic / election cycle the global hegemon. Like, I think that's over. And I don't know what that means. I feel like live theater will come back, kind of stuff, you know, restaurants will be open. I think communities will sort of find themselves, but I don't see a continuation, which, like, you know, I don't know how I feel about any of it, but yeah, I think this election, the November to January period, is going to be bad.
Rough. Yeah, it's the fear, isn't it?
You know, I don't know. My now husband's major role in our relationship is pulling me back from the brink of like, pack your shit. And he's like, our passports don't even work. Like, we can't go where. Like, it's not. And also, like, we're at a lake house. It feels sick, but like, even as a very outspoken like sex worker rights advocate, and like this government, like the United States has a long history of like running mouthy women out of town, right? But also has a long history of like at least doing a good impression of respecting the rights of like propertied white people. And so like, I feel illegitimate in my fear for myself, but I have all of the rational fear for so many people that have been fucked for so long in this country that like even this feels like a matter of degree. But yeah, so that's, I don't know.
So pretty positive for the future.
Yeah, you're feeling good. Feeling pretty good.
Yeah, I'm feeling good. You know, the renovation is going well. Yeah, our kitchen's going to be beautiful.
Like
6 months,
it's like it's going to be Groundhog's Day. So do you want any predictions on that?
No, that was more
what I was going for, but yeah.
Oh, yeah. In 6 months, I predict that my husband and I will be back in Chelsea in our freshly renovated apartment, and I will be recording episodes in the office that he's building me. So that's my personal, my life is going awesome, even as we descend into chaos.
Beautiful.
Yeah. I'm fine.
Yeah. Fine. And then one last thing we do, because we're not saying goodbye, because through the miracle of editing, we're going to continue talking. But we have been challenging our guests to either start a sentence or a joke that they do not know how will end. And then we will stitch it together. So we'll begin the next interview with your ending or joke.
So I have to write this now. I have to write the setup now.
Yeah.
And then remember it. Or
we'll send you a copy of this.
As I have 6 months to workshop a punchline.
Yes.
Fuck. Let's see. A part of me wants to go really hacky. I'm like, being married is.
You can go hacky. I love
hacky.
That.
Maybe yeah, in 6 months you'll come up with the. I think well,
the punchline to that is I miss airplane food.
Yeah.
Two hacky jokes put together and only make sense in this context. That's fine. I mean, aspirational. Let's see. Yeah. No. Yeah. I guess being married during a global pandemic is.
I like everything else. Easier if you're rich and white.
No.
Oh yeah.
It's not. There's no lie.
Right, yeah, but it's like I don't know if that's right. It's like I feel like it's an acknowledgement of white privilege, but it's also like I don't know. It means like how do you?
It's like it's funny and sad at the same time. That's one of those funny sad ones. Like,
yeah, not funny because it's true. Is that a category of jokes?
Perhaps. Yeah. I think, well, not funny because it's true is just tragedy.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, that is the state of affairs of race relations and economic inequality. I feel like, the pandemic has been a big reveal on, we are an ecosystem.
Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, it's so good to talk to you.
Everything's broken.
I'm so happy.
Yeah, it's so good to see you too. I missed you guys.
I'm so excited. It's so nice. You look great. You look so happy. Where are you? Oh, you like your prediction was back in Chelsea. Where are you?
Yep. Here I sit. I am in Chelsea in my not quite finished office.
Fantastic.
But it's okay. We finished the renovation. we're waiting on, we got to do sound, we got to do fancy sound stuff to it for audio stuff. And we're waiting on some things. And like, there's a couple of renovation-y stuff that has to be done before I can like unload my books and unpack and stuff. But we are in the settling in phase, and it feels great. By come springtime, this is going to be a real house home.
That's so exciting.
Or apartment home.
Nice.
It'll be a real homey apartment.
That's good to hear. When did you move back in?
We moved in January 30th because out of sheer stubbornness, I wanted to make it happen in 2020.
Well, that's good. I'm glad you got back into your apartment. Your other prediction also kind of came true, which is that the 3 months between the election and the inauguration would be pretty crazy.
Yeah. That was a nutso time. You guys, you know, the insurrection happened. People died. I feel, you know, it's like, yes, Biden is president. Like, yes, the system, like, things could have gone much, much worse. But yeah, we were real fucking close to watching a mass execution. That was real nip tuck bob weave, as my father would say.
Wow.
Yeah. So
it was really intense. Yeah. It felt like it was a shock to be watching it and being like, whoa, that's America. You know, like from outside of America to be watching that, being like, this is not like some country that America's going in to save. Like, this is America.
It's hot collar moment on that. Woo, what have been the last 100 years of our international policy? Woo, hot moment. So question, was the thought, oh my God, Kaytlyn Bailey was so right, just go in your head over and over again? Or was that, or is that just me by myself? Like, I've been right about everything since I was 13. My last 6 months.
Yeah, I had forgotten what you said, and then I listened back to it last week, and I was like, she's a witch. she knows things. Don't tell me how I'm gonna die.
The good thing is you have genuine evidence of your prediction as well, so you can totally show people.
Yeah, I'm not just drunk at a not party.
You just need to listen to this podcast. It's 40 minutes of us talking, but then I say something really insightful.
Yeah, really insightful. That ended up being true later. You should listen to me. I'm sorry. Listen to Sex Worker. Stop the arrest. It's bad for everyone.
So kudos on that. You know, next time, give the Capitol Police a heads up.
Right, yeah. I mean, people tried.
Yeah, it's fair. It's fair.
Yeah, they have a long history of not listening to sex workers, I bet. Yeah.
Speaking of listening to sex workers, you're in the middle of season three. Or no, you've ended. Did you end season three?
No, we're in the middle of season three.
You're still in the middle of season three of the Oldest Profession podcast that got back up and running. Some real bangers of episodes. A lot of multi-part episodes on bigger topics. The Stonewall one. Mm-hmm. I really loved the Lilith one.
Oh, thank you.
That's a topic that I've always really been kind of fascinated by, and I've never really known a lot about it. So I was really interested to listen to that little three-parter. So that was really good. So how does it feel being back in the studio with podcasting and everything?
Yeah, I mean, it feels great. You know, we got the season started. We started in October. I re-listened to the podcast, and that was back when I had the pipe dream that this would all come together by September. But we were a month late. We started in October. With Victoria Woodhull, the first woman to run for president, and then Marsha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera, and the history of Stonewall, and really the history of chosen family and queer culture in New York City. And that you know, that lives to this day, that we are, you know, we have survivors of that legacy working and operating today. And then, you know, as you said, we moved on to Lilith. We got a special episode in there on election night. Dr. Fletcher and I got super drunk and talked about Melania Trump for 2 hours. And it's not interesting, but it is sort of funny. And we did record it on election night, and both, you know, Dr. Fletcher and I are just, swigging our anxiety away, talking shit about the soon-to-be ex-first lady, rolling the dice on whether or not that was about to become a capital offense, you know? Trump's second term. Like, I don't know, are we signing our death warrant, or is just blowing off steam? Yeah, the Lilith part we did as our December series, and then we started the new year off with the Old Pro Project, which I'm really, really proud of and excited about, to celebrate the anniversary of the first sex worker-led protest in the U.S., which happened January 25th. And so we ended up funding these art builds in 5 cities across the country, where activists and artists were able to create these group projects celebrating our shared history and all coming together and culminating on this day of national significance that doesn't get any recognition. and in that way really bring sex worker advocates and artists to the table. And so for all of January, we passed to the mic and Dr. Fletcher led panels with folks that were involved in the Old Pro Project. And I've gone back and listened to those episodes a couple of times. And that, I have to say, is one of the things that I'm most proud of in our first quarter as a company, is being able to empower and get the resources into the hands of storytellers at like truly the grassroots level of this international movement. Felt really great and a really powerful legacy to be a part of.
So, oh my gosh. Wow.
I mean, that's a lot for, you know, getting back in it, and then like that seems like a really big project.
Yeah, it blew up from, it started as a small idea and then just kind of spiraled and became this massive group project, and really became, you know, what everyone that participated in it made it. It's only kind of in looking back, really, because like when you're in it, you just, it's just chaos coming at you all the time from all directions, like trying to do an art project like with activists in 2020. Literally, we had three cities on fire at the same time, like Seattle, Portland, and San Francisco were all ablaze, and we're doing like group meetings with like, how's your art project going? Like, can you breathe? I don't know. Like, it's, you know, it was definitely a lot, but we pulled it off, and I'm so proud of what we built. And if you have a chance, if you haven't already, please do yourself a favor and watch the music video that came out of Seattle, been around since the old days, featuring sex worker activists in Seattle and original music. And it's the sex worker rights anthem of 2021.
I'm looking it up now.
Excellent. Oh, that's great. It'll be on the web. I actually put it on the website. Yeah. On the listing for the episode.
Fantastic. I'm so impressed that you've managed to do this stuff like during what is essentially kind of chaos. Do you know what I mean? Like, as in like the world has been like such a crazy time. I feel like anyone's doing well to do anything other than like survive. You know what I mean? So the fact that you're like organizing these things just, it blows my mind. I think it's amazing.
I mean, thank you so much for saying it, but I really can't overstate enough how not killing it I was in like the normal world, right? Like, I got kicked off food stamps for not doing my paperwork. I didn't have health insurance for a decade. I tried to treat BV with garlic. Like, I was a mess as a working artist in New York trying to figure out this unnavigable system. But the chaos of the world falling, like, not the world, but like systems falling apart, right? The entire ecosystem of stand-up comedy being swept away, right? The entire, like, so much of what I knew about the world, even the nature of politics and like what we were doing, and it all seemed to kind of disappear. And that was the permission slip I needed to just build what I wanted myself, like let go of the pre-existing systems or structures, stop trying to fit yourself in to somebody else's thing, build what you want. And I have this vision of being able to travel around the country doing stand-up or readings or lectures or reading from some piece that I'm working on, kind of like a it not mattering, but like me talking into a microphone with other sex worker artists in like a variety show. Sex workers are talented, and you know, being able to put these like sort of micro concerts together all over the country, partnering with different organizations to basically reawaken local sex worker history, right? We can partner with breweries and they can do runs of beers with you know, local artists doing stuff inspired by local old pros, right? We can bring in a tour guide to give a little talk. We can have, you know, a local band write a little song. You know, like, we can lean on this hyper local ecosystem of advocates and storytellers and actively shift the narrative about the oldest profession. And none of our legislative goals and none of our social goals, none of our funding goals are ever going to get met if we can't change that story. And I think that, like, the you know, I feel very, very wooey when I go off on these tangents, but like, you know, I really do feel like the power to change already exists within us. Like, all we have to do is start paying attention to these stories that we already have. Every local town has some badass mouthy old pro that got arrested sometime between 1860 and 1890 that said something amazing to some dumb sexist judge. Every single town in America has that person, and we should do a beer run about all of them.
Yeah. Oh, do you know what? If anyone has that power within them, it's certainly you. Like every time I listen to you, listening back to that for the first half, I was just like, God, it just, you know, you say what you talk about, it just makes everything make so much sense. And like, you speak about it so well.
Thank you. Yeah, well, I mean, we just wrapped up the Old Pro Project January 25th. Right now, we are producing a documentary in partnership with Swap Behind Bars covering the quote-unquote anti-trafficking efforts of Florida's law enforcement and making sure to highlight, like, the gap between what cops say they're doing and what they're actually doing, and the coalition of, like, sex workers and harm reduction folks that have to come together to try to mitigate the aftermath of these violent raids, arrests, and public humiliation that is, like, sold to the American tax dollar. Is sold to the American taxpayer as, like, righteous anti-trafficking efforts. So I'm really excited about capturing the work of Swap Behind Bars and this coalition and trying...
Are you saying Swap?
Swap, yeah. Sex Worker Outreach Project.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, SWAP, sorry. SWAB. We're bad at acronyms, swerkers.
Wait, are we called SWAB?
But yeah, no, I'm really looking forward to highlighting their work and hoping to create a piece that highlights the real harm of this false narrative, right? Like the hours and hours and hours that Florida legislators and lawmakers and law enforcement have spent declaring themselves heroes and people who really genuinely want to help, you know, women, children that are in a rough situation, that are giving more and more money to cops, right? Which are like the number one harassers of people in the sex industry. I think that as soon as people understand what's happening, they'll object to it. And so I think it's just a matter of capturing that and making sure that we can show people what's really going on.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah. So like the January 25th date, which is the, I was listening to that podcast, the Why January 25th is Important one that you put out.
Oh, thank you.
Very interesting. Was it your organization that kind of like centered in on this January 25th date and said like, let's make this a focal point and maybe like as an annual, are you trying to like-
We're trying to
maybe
turn it into an annual event. We want it to be, we eventually want it to turn into, you know, an annual fundraising event, but certainly an annual event where we would envision each one of these cities sort of hosting their own event where they could feature, you know, sex worker performers locally, you know, making it an annual celebration. And we're not quite sure. We know that that will look different everywhere. And we're not sure where we're centering our energy on that, except fundraising for this project and making sure that we're focusing on developing the resources and developing the relationships that we need to make this, like, you know, scalable and repeatable.
I mean, that's great, because if you make it like an event every year, you're getting in the media, you're bringing attention to people, you know, maybe people read an article about it, maybe it changes, you know, you get public opinion shifts that way. I mean, that's great. That's the way that you really start to foment a movement.
And it also feels like a great way to give local sex worker artists and activists a reason to collaborate and cooperate on a local project together, which is a great way to build capacity. And it's a good reason to get a lot of different kinds of people together, right? You've got local businesses that can help support the event. You have local performers. It's a great way to loop, you know, New York did a great job of looping in local politicians to their event. Local nonprofits. It just like sparks a lot of community collaboration, which I think is like the real glue of movement building, right? It's like getting all of these people focused on the same thing and learning about local sex worker history and the history of sex worker resistance is a really, really great way of educating so many different kinds of people in the community, including sex worker activists. You know, like, I can't tell you how many longtime sex worker activists we worked closely with that had not heard the story of Lou Graham, that had not heard the story of Lulu White, that were not aware of, you know, the generations of advocacy that predated us. And I feel like we are worse off for a movement because of it, because we keep losing our history, right? We lose the opportunity to build on the mistakes and the infrastructure and the systems of those that came before us. And I think so this is a sort of a long-term capacity building strategy with this event.
Oh, well, that is so exciting. And what about you're back in New York, like, what is your, like, over the last 6 months, like, what has happened since we thought you were at the lake house last time we spoke to you? How long were you there? What's life kind of looked like in the last 6 months?
I feel like the big development. So we spoke, was it July when we?
July 30th.
July 30th. Okay. Yeah. So that was, so what happened next is I started feeding the wild animals dog food and we got a real menagerie of possums and raccoons and a couple of skunks and at least one gray fox. And that was very exciting. And then I went on antidepressants, which was also very helpful. That was great.
Okay.
And then my husband and I really kind of packed up. You know, we did Thanksgiving with my family and we did Christmas with his family. And there was a lot of borrowing the truck and like going back and forth to New York during that like sort of period of time, a lot of just movement in October, November, December. Oh, there's one more thing that I want to say that I think is important, which was this was a year of possums for me. Okay. When I started feeding the wild animals, I had really hoped to feed raccoons and foxes. That's who I was aiming for. But I only attracted possums for like the first 4 weeks. And they are the most punk rock animal that I've ever made eye contact with. They are weird. And so I went as a possum for Halloween. And there are some great pictures of that.
I'll post one on the Instagram.
Hanging out at my best friend's house. Fantastic. Yeah. I don't know if that aside is worth it. I thought that was very exciting, but like I see why no one would care.
I feel like possums are having a moment now. I feel like a lot of people are posting like possum memes and just possum love on Facebook and stuff.
I get it. They don't give a fuck. And that is hard not to appreciate.
And they can be really cute in their own way. And I don't know. And they can't get rabies. They're pretty cool.
They're pretty. And they eat ticks. they chomp down. Yeah. They help eat ticks.
They're putting a lot of good out in the world, possums.
Absolutely.
I feel like they're not, and they don't get the credit for it because they're not as cute as raccoons.
Yeah. I mean, raccoons are smarter, but whatever.
More confused. I was sort of like, I found it funny because obviously like the menagerie thing seemed really positive, and then that went straight to that you'd gone on to antidepressants, and I was like, is this directly related to the menagerie or
Well, then because at first I thought it was like you were like a Snow White figure bringing all of these beautiful woodland creatures
that's
to you, and
I
then after you
myself.
Said you put on antidepressants, I was like, oh, it's just you in a bathrobe just like sat crying and throwing dog food on the ground. It's like,
both of those visuals are accurate, right? So like I saw myself as more of a Disney princess, right? And my husband saw it more as a cry for help. And so we were able to sort of get real about the fact that I was like no longer getting dressed and was becoming more feral-ish in my own behavior as I attracted more and more wild animals to me and was just sort of transforming into a wild woman in the woods.
Right.
And my husband was like, we do have to re-enter society. And so I went on Prozac and whew, that's a great lube for the world.
Wait, are you still on it at the moment?
I went on it with the intention of just like, as we've sort of talked about, I had a lot to get done, right? I was starting a business and trying to get things off the ground, and I really could not focus because of all of the November to January chaos. And I felt like I saw that coming.
You did?
And so it was August, September that I initially went on antidepressants to try to focus my mind or try to take the edge off the like real anxiety I felt in my body. But I didn't feel like my brain, I did not feel like I was wrong. You know what I mean? I felt like my brain was like accurately responding, but it was just inactionable. It's like, there's nothing I can do about the incoming insurrection, but I do need to like map out these podcast episodes and I have to be able to stay focused for that. And so I went on the antidepressants with the clear intention of getting back off of them. And so my therapist and I, my goal, it's hard, like I'm going to do whatever's right for my brain, but my intention is to go off of them by this spring to sort of spend the winter with this transition and start, you know, March or April, the taper off process.
You know, that's good. It's good to have a plan. It's good to, I mean, I'm a big advocate for, I'm staying on your meds. Mm-hmm. I'm on my meds. You know, everybody's in, you know, and don't. I've made the mistake of just being like, I don't need this anymore. And then just kind of stopping on my own. And it is good to just, you know, to check in with, like, to have a plan with a therapist and, you know, all that. So it's good.
It's so funny you say that because it's like,
have so much internalized shame and weirdness around antidepressants because my mom went on antidepressants when I was like a young person. And we didn't really talk about it in the family, but we talked about it sort of obliquely, but it wasn't like a safe space to like ask questions around. And my mother, I discovered later, just suffered from like sexual side effects. And that's kind of like when my parents' sexual relationship ended. And and that I have a lot of baggage and weirdness around that. And I haven't experienced those symptoms on antidepressants. Like that's not what happened for me. And the person that I've been seeing, it's so funny to me that like I don't have a problem smoking pot every day. But like there's something in me that is resistant to this idea of being someone who is on antidepressants. Even though when I like go back and I read my like second or third grade journal, it's like I've been depressed my whole life. That's like it's consistent. It's like, and so I struggle with these like narratives and self-identities and like I don't know, there's just stuff.
I totally get it. I'm at the moment I've been trying to end therapy because I've been going every week for a year and I keep being to my therapist like I think I'm ready to end now, and he's kind of like I don't really know if you are, and I'm like I think it's just because I feel like I can't be someone that's in therapy my whole life. But then it's like that thing of it's not like I'm going every week necessarily because I'm still like in a really bad place. It's more just it's really helped me so much and it's still helping me, so why am I trying to end it? It's like it's that thing of just it is a stigma thing still for myself, but it's in my own head, you know.
Yep. Mm-hmm. You're absolutely right, and I've felt the benefits of being on antidepressants since the beginning. You know, this feels better. And also because the story that I told myself of like, oh, this is a coping mechanism to get through a difficult time, and it's this externalization. Mm-hmm. Right? Because I feel like in going on antidepressants, I'm like admitting that there's something broken or wrong with me. And it feels like I'm fulfilled. And that ties into the sex worker advocacy, right? Of like, anybody that does this would be crazy. And there's so much ableism and toxicity and mom shit. And it gets all wrapped up together. But these also feel like issues I should be bringing to my therapist and not your podcast audience. But basically, take your drugs. Or don't. Life is complicated.
Get the help you need.
Get the help you need.
And don't feel ashamed. Like, don't feel guilty. Don't feel ashamed.
Yeah, and it's not linear. There's no shame. Yeah, and you can change your mind.
Okay, so getting back to... You were driving the truck up to New York a lot.
Yeah. Well, no, I guess as soon as I said that, I was like, oh, if my husband listens to this, I'm going to get called out. I'm sorry. My husband and father-in-law made multiple trips to New York, delivering furniture and carrying heavy things and navigating the snow while I did 10 hours of calls a day to make things happen.
Okay. So you're doing admin. You're not, it's not like, you know, everybody's playing to their strength.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, I am staying here and you are leaving.
Yeah. I would much rather drive a great distance and move heavy furniture than ever to have even one conversation on the phone.
See, yeah, that's, so. There you go. Yeah. So my husband and I played to our strengths. He played car Tetris and I talked to people who are a mysterious, you know, phenomenon, difficult to see, not very predictable, hard to plug into an algorithm.
Sure. And then you moved back in at the end of December, was it? The end of December you moved?
Yes, December 30th. So like the last December. I said January 30th. I misspoke earlier. Okay. So yeah, so we moved up December 30th, just at the last few days. We had a very quiet New Year's. I think my husband and I both had this idea in our head that this like ordeal would be over, that we were going home, right? That we'd like been displaced since March and we had just sort of kept uprooting our lives and, you know, staying with my best friend and like doing, and that we were going to get home and be home. But of course, that's not what happened. We just did a renovation. So we got home to the beginnings of 1,001 unpacking projects. And so the first couple of weeks that we were home, both of us, I think, were really tense and like short with each other. It felt very claustrophobic because we went from like being at a lake house and faces and suburban homes where we were able to go outside without a mask. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, not the case. We live in an elevator building. Like, there's no way to breathe fresh air without a mask, like without walking several blocks. So, you know, and still we're in a very lush situation, right? This is very, mm-hmm. very, very flush. You know, I think that there was just an adjustment of expectations. But once we got a few big projects out of the way and we're able to start really unpacking boxes, like, we're just going to be able to take our time to settle in. But, I mean, transitions are just rough. You know, that's just, and we've done a lot of them. And we thought it was over. And it wasn't quite. And it never will be. There's no finishing. You're never going to graduate from therapy. And my husband and I are never going to stop packing and unpacking boxes. That's what life is, basically. Just a series of packing and unpacking boxes.
Yeah.
Literally and metaphorically.
There was some Seinfeld bit and it was just like, and then you die.
Right,
And they put you in a box and it's that last
it's big move. It's just that last big move,
But yeah, moving sucks. It's nice, you know, it's good when you move into your own place. Like we bought a house a couple years ago and you move all your stuff in and you're like, cool, I don't need to worry about this is somebody else's space that I'm borrowing. It's like, this is my space, you know, and that's really nice. And, you know, everything you had was like tightly folded up and then you slowly kind of unfold it into the space. You know, I mean, I feel like we were 6 months before we put any art on the wall.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and then when we finally did it, it was just like, oh, this is like, people live here.
Yeah.
It's nice, you know, it's not just.
I mean, we do not have the pressure of entertaining, which is a nice, you know, both a plus and minus of the COVID era. Yeah. Cause I feel like at this point we would have to plan a party to motivate ourselves to do anything. But now without that, we're taking our sweet time, which is nice.
Yeah. You know? So the last 6 months, it's been transitional for you, but it sounds like, I don't know, you got a lot of amazing projects that you're working on. Was there anything that really surprised you over the last 6 months or maybe surprised you listening back to what we talked about? Like listen to yourself on the thing, on the previous recording?
The thing. Yeah, the thing that you're doing. I mean, it felt really nice to listen to the enthusiasm and direction and clear-sightedness of like, 6 months ago me and still be in it and feel like I'm executing the plan. You know what I mean? It's like it feels good because I feel like there's when you're in it, it is, you were saying, Tara, it's fucking chaos. It's just a cloud. You can see an inch in front of your nose, right? And that's it. And it's just a cloud, a fog of like self-doubt and unexpected dumb problems. You know, like just the dumb stuff that gets in the way, like our online bank is closing. So we had to completely uproot the whole banking and like everything's connected to our fiscal sponsor and our and people who are able to donate online. Like we have to uproot and just undo all of that by the end of March because the bank that we're choosing is going out of business. So like it's just like it's like stuff like that that just eats away, you know, dozens and dozens of hours a week. You know, chunk after chunk. And so being able to step back and take a longer view of what it is that we are doing and the bigness of that, you know, and it's nice. It feels really nice. Cause when you're in it feels mostly like anxiety and dread, but it's great. Yeah.
I mean,
can't recommend it.
It must have been satisfying to be like, oh, the things I said I was going to do 6 months ago, they're done. Yeah. Or they're in, you know, they're in some stage of completion. Yeah. And that's, you know, that's gotta feel gratifying. So
yeah, I mean, I feel like in many ways the next 6 months look less clear. You know, so much about the next 6 months is dependent on securing funding. We have a lot of would do's, could do's, shoulds, but like all of it we're singularly focused right now on trying to secure our next 6 months of funding. And we think that with what we did in the last 6 months, you know, we have the proof, you know, moving for the proof of concept, right? That we optimistic, confident, but not calm. We are confident, but not calm in our ability to secure that funding. But the first 6 months were about getting started. And then, you know, we're dog paddling to survive at the moment, like many other startups and nonprofits.
Sure.
Yeah.
Do you feel happy still that you moved on from your old job? Like, as in, do you feel that was definitely the right decision?
Oh my God, it was just like the abortion. There hasn't been a second of regret. Like, didn't even cross my mind that like, oh, maybe I should have a kid right now. Or like, oh, maybe I should, yeah, I know. It's been, and it went sour. Like the last few weeks were really bad. Like I put in my notice and I was able to focus on projects internally at DSW that I'm still really proud of that have come out since. You know, they did an animated video series that I, you know, did a lot of the writing and voiceover work for. The one pager project that they have is, or that we built together, I think is an asset to anyone that comes across it. And like, I'm still very, very proud of the work that I was able to do at DSW. And also, I couldn't do any of the things that I have done if I was still there or had maintained a relationship with them. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, that's great. I'm so happy. Like, it's just been so wonderful to hear about everything you're doing, and I really hope everything goes well. Is there anything that you'd like to plug that you can plug now in terms of like social media or like ways that people can support what you're doing?
Oh yeah. Please go to theoldestprofessionpodcast.com or oldproproject.com, depending on what you want to hear more about. Please like check out all of the amazing projects that sex worker advocates were able to do all over the country. Share that. Get on our mailing list. We do a newsletter every week that's a roundup of old pro news and all the stuff we're up to. So if you want to hear more or be one of the first to know about tickets available for Whore's Eye View and other stuff like that, then get on the old pro mailing list.
Thanks. Amazing. Well, thank you so much, Kaytlyn. I've really loved meeting you and talking to you. And yeah, it's so good to see you again.
It's fun. It's great to see you again. Sounds like everything's going great for you. So
thank you.
It's exciting. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much for this opportunity. This is a really, really cool concept. I'm thrilled to see this being well executed. And good luck with your new baby, Matthew. That's very exciting.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. Thank you. So, do you remember all what we talked about?
Oh, yes, I do. I made some notes.
Cool.
Let me just have a look. I was thinking, like, it was nice listening to you talking about getting strollers and stuff, and like, and now it's happening, like now it's all, you're like right in the middle of all of that.
I forget if I told you this, but we ended up buying a stroller, like a new stroller, because we did try to go on like Facebook Marketplace or Gumtree or something and had some people who were selling old strollers, and then the first one we went to, one of the wheels wouldn't lock. Mm-hmm. So then if you like could only lock one of the rear wheels, then just the stroller spins around. It's like, well, that's not helpful. And then another one, we went to this house, you know, we went in there and they were showing the stroller and it seemed really good. You know, they'd been showing us how to fold it and unfold it. I was like, can I try it once? And she took it and then she tried to fold it and it made this like cracking noise. And then it wouldn't fold up anymore. And then the lady was there and she like got her husband in, and he's like, oh, I don't know why it's not working. And I don't know. I knew immediately what happened as soon as the cracking noise happened. But then like everybody else seemed to be like, oh, it doesn't seem to be working. And I was like, yep, let's go. Yep. Well, we're not going to buy this. See you later. Bye. And as soon as we got out of the house, I was like, we broke their stroller. Like, and I felt so bad. And I was like, look, I'm never going to another house to look at strollers again. Cause we've had that. I can't ever face another human being with the level of anxiety that just caused in me. Like, that was too much. Like, let's just buy a regular stroller. And then Alice ended up getting a message from the people whose house we went to, and the lady was like, hey, so the stroller broke, so can you pay us some money to fix it? And we were like, no. It was like, I don't know what to do. Like, yeah, it broke and we're sorry that we were involved in that, but at the same time, it's like, wouldn't, like, if we'd have bought it from you, wouldn't it have just broken anyways? I don't know. We were just like, no, we're not gonna give any money for this. It's anyways, they were very well off. They did anyway. So it was like the most stressful thing, I think, you know, of the pregnancy, was just this interaction we had with going to these strangers' houses and like breaking their stroller.
Oh my god, that sounds horrendous.
But it was horrible. So we just bought a regular stroller. The thing that was funny listening back was like, I was like, man, I haven't been on a train in 6 months. Like, I still haven't been on a train, I think, since that one trip we took to Cornwall, which is kind of crazy.
Oh yeah.
Because, you know, before, you used to take the train all the time, just wherever. Sometimes not to nowhere in particular. Just taking it just to ride the train.
I'm just getting on the train.
Yeah.
For just a ride.
See where it goes.
I thought it was funny listening back and the fact that you'd watched the puzzle movie and then Esther never even bothered to watch it.
Esther never watched it. That broke my heart too. I was listening to that about how excited I was to talk to Esther about the puzzle movie, and then Esther didn't even watch the puzzle moves.
Yeah, that was really funny. You're
so
like
upset about
your
that.
Genuine like joy, and the fact that you actually thought she'd watch it as well. I thought that was really funny. Really,
I did. I thought she'd watch it. She seemed really into the idea. I thought we were gonna be like puzzle watching buddy film. And even in the follow-up email I sent, I was like, I hope you watch that puzzle movie, because I was like, it was the standard boilerplate, you know, these are the kind of questions we're gonna ask and here's the scheduled time. And it was also like, P.S. I hope you watch that puzzle movie because I want to talk about the puzzle movie.
And she didn't even bother, so
she didn't watch it. You didn't watch it either, so don't even pretend like you're better than Esther.
No, but I never said I would, and I never showed any interest in it, so I think I was honest. Fine. At least I thought it was. Anyways. One thing I found interesting was listening back to me talking about doing that first gig again after that period of, I guess, 4 months or whatever it had been, and how anxious I felt.
Yeah.
And now it's like, wow, it's just been so much longer now. But I think what it made me realize was, like, I felt sort of almost hacky going back to, like, old pre-COVID material, like motherhood material from, like, my, you know, previous Edinburgh show and stuff. And I now, what it actually made me think, listening back to it today, I was like, I don't think I'm ever going to do that material again. And maybe I should just release that show, because I do have it taped from when I performed at Soho Theatre and when I performed it at the Fringe and stuff. Maybe I should just release it as like an album, you know, a short album, and just be like, okay, that material's gone now. Like, I can't obviously use it again because it's now on this album, but I don't care, because I feel like I've sort of moved on from that point now in my life. Like, it's just, I feel like that material is kind of done.
Sure.
Yeah. So that was what it made me think.
Yeah. I think that's a good idea. I think, I don't know, in America, people used to just do an album. Like, a lot of comedians would just be like, this is my album. This is just material I'm done with. You know, I'll build up and I'll do this album and I'll put it out myself. And it's very DIY. A lot of people, and, you know, sometimes people's albums are not great, but then it's still, it's always a nice thing to have out there that you can direct people to and say, like, oh, here's a thing that is my work. And it's nice to be able to file that away and look back on it, I think, yourself. So I think that that's,
I think I'm just ready to do that with it now. I feel like I'm letting it go. Where are you at? Like, where are you at in your life? Obviously, you had a baby on Saturday. It's Wednesday. You know, do you want to say anything about how, you know, that's going? Or
no, it's been amazing. This first week has been great. It's been, you know, I will say, I thought it would be really weird and I wouldn't be able to figure it out. And I'm amazed at how absolutely, like, natural it becomes. You know, once, like, I don't know, I've always been very, like, anxious around children, like I was gonna hurt them or something, or dudes, because they seem so small and fragile and whatever, and they are, but, like, my capacity to deal with Tavish is more than I thought I would be able to, you know, to do. Like, it's amazing how natural it does come. And how much, like, how much I really like him, and how much it is, he's just a sweet little guy. He doesn't do anything. He doesn't have much of a personality, but I'm still like, he doesn't have any personality, really. I mean, it's just like, it's just great to, like, just look at his dumb face, you know, and I don't know. It's, you know, and he does the thing where he, like, holds on to your finger with his whole hand, and it's just like, it's so strong, and, you know, I don't know. It's just like, it's crazy. It's just really nuts. And so, yeah, it's been a really weird week, but, like, amazing.
Oh, that's so beautiful. God, it's so nice to like, kind of capture these moments of, like, new parenthood, because I feel like I've just forgotten so much of those things. Like, I'd completely forgotten about how they hold onto your finger with their whole hand. Like, that's such a beautiful thing to think about. Yeah, that's wow.
That's great.
That's amazing.
So, anyways, thanks everybody for listening. Really appreciate it. Please rate, review, subscribe.
If you can follow us on @6MonthsLaterPod, or if you want to support us on Patreon, you can search for 6 Months Later Podcast, or you can go to our website, 6MonthsLaterPod.com. We would be so grateful. And you can find me, my personal TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, etc., @TaraNWComedy.
I am M. Shadorn on all the things. I'm more on Instagram than anything else. You can go to my Twitter account, but it is useless. I haven't done anything there in years. But if you want to go back and read some of my old tweets, here's a great one from December 16th, 2013. Well, I'm off to work, or as I call it, the abattoir of my youth and dreams. So that's the kind of, like, like, uplifting material you can find buried in the depths of my now derelict Twitter account. But thanks everybody for listening, and we'll see you next week
in 6 months. Thanks so much, guys.
Bye everybody.
Bye.
Sorry. Sorry, I didn't mean to be all like really heavy.
Hey, don't you be sorry, like you're going through some shit and we love you. We're here to support you. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, Kaytlyn, do some jokes to entertain me.
Dance, whore.
Thanks. All right. That was maybe that came in a little bit too hot.